Good afternoon. Thank you for joining our panel, Living on and Off the Land. My name is Fatimah Hasan, and I am so honored to be here with you. So right now, we have a great group of distinguished panelists, and hopefully you have learned more about them from their bio, which you can get to by clicking on to our panel. So we will hear from each of the speakers and the gifts that they're bringing, their insights, their memories from the work that they do. And then we will show the inspiring film, 20 and Odd, which explores 400 years of the African-American experience as expressed through the sites that are managed by the National Park Service. So that's going to be a real treat. And we will entertain questions from the audience for what promises to be a very lively and thought-provoking discussion. So here are our panelists. Jaren Hill Lockridge, director of The Well at Oxon Run. We have Monica Esparza, educator and founder of AfroCity and trustee of the Renewal of Life Land Trust. George McDonald, chief of the Youth Programs Division and Experienced Services Program for the National Park Service. Mathew John, audiovisual production specialist at the National Park Service. And Subria Spencer, deputy liaison and communications specialist at the National Park Service. Okay, Jaren.
Good morning, everyone, and happy Black History Month. Let me start with that. I am Jaren Hill Lockridge, and I am the woman at the well. I first want to say thank you so much to the Audubon Naturalist Society for creating this platform of taking nature Black. And one of the things that I'm really excited to do is really identify and define what living on and off the land means for me and our community, particularly here in Southeast Washington, DC. I also want to say thank you so much to my esteemed peers on the panel. I applaud the work that each of you all do individually. And I also want to call out the shoulders of the giants that I stand, you know, the shoulders of the giants that I stand on. The Marion Barrys of the world, the James Bonds, the Wilhelmina Rollarks, the William Lockridges. I'm very clear that I wouldn't be here had it not been for them. And also making sure that my children understand their place in this. I have an 11-year-old son and twin identical twin girls, and I do this for them. And with that being said, let me just get into what the well is and really lay out what we're doing. The well is going to be an urban farm oasis right here in Southeast Washington, D.C. The mission is going to really be to increase resilience and increase wellness for our community. And we're defining resilience as a combination of inner strength and outer resources. And what we know is that we as a people have never lacked the inner strength, but it's been those outer resources that we have that's really been lacking. And when we talk about the call and response and the theme of this year's conference, this is a very clear response to the call of what the people have done and our ancestors have done, our elders have done before us. With that being said, this is a transfer of resources. Let me say that I am an employee of DC Greens. And DC Greens is an amazing organization that's working to increase food access, food justice, and equity right here in our nation's capital. And DC Greens has been doing this work for a very long time. And for 8 years, they had a farm on K Street, right here in the heart of DC. And for those that don't know, K Street is, you know, where a lot of big money is, where a lot of the lobbyists are. And for DC Greens to be able to guerrilla garden and do some amazing work to really increase food access and production was amazing. That is amazing. But one of the things that I want to be clear about is not everybody would be able to guerrilla garden on K Street, right? And as a result, that land ended up being part of a land swap with the utility company and Pepco and DC United. As everybody knows, gentrification and development is a real thing, right? So using the resources and privilege that DC Greens had, they identified a plot of land over in Southeast DC, right? Ward 8, which is where I am, my home. And that's when I got involved, right? Around that time, we were doing Art All Night, the Chocolate City Edition, and really beginning to make it pop. For those that don't know, we have one of two intersections where Malcolm X and Martin Luther King meet. And right there, we had about 20,000 people and created over $100,000 in revenue in less than 24 hours. Now, in this one day pop-up, right, with this beautiful art and cultural expression, it only lasted for one day. So when DC Greens came over to Southeast with what I saw as a blank check and a blank canvas, I said, I understand that garden and farming and food access is very important, but we could do so much more. You could do so much more. So can we use food as art, right? And begin to showcase our culture beyond the one day festival of what Art All Night had done. It was an amazing platform, but we wanted a place that we could like look at our art on a more regular basis. And at that point, the farm evolved into the well, right? Beautiful, like beautiful evolution of things that happened. At the well, we're using food and physical wellness as an entry point to talk about all the things that are gonna make us better as a community. That includes physical wellness, environmental wellness, spiritual wellness, financial wellness, all the things that are gonna make us better as a people. And that's what we're doing at the well. I am so excited to lead this mission. I am so excited to bring this vision to fruition. We're breaking ground any day now to do like an amazing planting season all summer, all fall. The things that we are gonna grow and cultivate here, we're gonna really try to epitomize what it means to live on and off the land here in our nation's capital, particularly in the soul of the city of Ward 8. So with that being said, that's who I am and that's our platform. And I'm really excited to work with you guys today and tell you all of the great things about what we're doing.
Thank you, Jaren. Okay, and next we have Monica Esparza.
Good afternoon, everybody. It is an extreme pleasure to be here. I also want to thank the Audubon Naturalist Society for this platform, for all the planners, presenters, the people on this panel. Want to first also give thanks and honor to our ancestors. My background includes civil rights work in parks and transportation. I'm pleased to work independently with the Renewal of Life Trust and AfroCity Tours to encourage people back to Eden, which was humanitarian's first teacher of earth stewardship. And I'm thankful to my father who taught me of our spiritual inheritance, as quoted by a dear friend, land is a family project. On and off the land for me is a matter of public and private access, which often boils down to economic access and the cultural struggle between owning land and land recognized as our mother that we just should all have relationship with. So thank you all so much for the opportunity to be on this panel and look forward to a robust conversation.
Great, thank you. Now we have George McDonald.
Well, thank you to the National Audubon Society for inviting me to this presentation. I'm the Chief of Youth Programs for the National Park Service. And we do a lot of work around natural and cultural resources on public lands. But when the issue is about living on the land and as it relates to Black folks, I go back to my family, which my extended family is from a rural part of South Carolina, Lynchburg, South Carolina, in Lee County. Even though I was born and raised in New York City in Harlem, we would go down there every summer, and especially to my great grandmother's farm. And this was a farm where they had chickens. There were vegetable gardens where everyone ate out of that off the land. I mean, you got your vegetables from the land. The farm animals were there. You sometimes ate those chickens, even though we thought of them as pets. to a certain degree. I had a goat, I had a pony as a little boy. And these are things that I could not experience when I was at home. And to this day, our family still owns several hundred acres of land down there. And this is really important as a part of our legacy as a family. And I think it's really important for us to look at air property and the importance of keeping air property within the family and sharing those experiences from generation to generation. Thank you.
Awesome, thank you so much. And now we're gonna hear from Mathew John.
Hi everyone, I'm Mathew John. I'm the audiovisual production specialist for the National Park Service. I make the videos for the Park Service. And I just wanna thank the Audubon Society for having me here as well. I'm always reminded, I was so lucky that I got to travel and be on so many details with the Department of Interior. And one of the details I took was with the Land Buyback Program, which is a Native American Bureau. And my goal was to go in and make videos for the landowners so they could watch this video and understand what the Land Buyback Program was about. And for me, it was just such a disconnect. They sent me out for 8 months, 6 months to travel and learn about the program, 2 months to make the video. And I was just having a hard time connecting with how to tell this story. And I got to work with one of the tribal liaisons, Santee Lewis, who's Navajo. And she told me something so amazing when I asked her. I said, what does land mean to Native Americans? And she said something I'll never forget. She said, land to Native Americans is like a mother. It's there to provide. And you can take from it, but it's there to provide for you. And you give honor to that mother. So I just kind of saw that disconnect because I think a lot of times the majority sees land as something that they can take and build upon and just develop. Whereas a lot of minorities, we just see land as something that gives to us and we have to give back to it. So that's kind of how I see this whole thing with land.
Great, thank you for that orientation to the land. We needed that. All right, Subria Spencer.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you to all of you who are on this panel today. Thank you, George, for recommending that Mathew and I join the discussion as well. My name is Subria Spencer, and I currently serve as Communication Education Specialist for the Office of Public Health at the National Park Service. I also served as a co-producer for the film that we will be watching later on, 20 and Odd. Mathew did not mention it, but Mathew served as the director and executive director for the film. So I know that we'll be able to get more into that discussion later on. I've really been thinking a lot about this title. Really grateful to have had conversations with our fellow panelists before the call, just to talk about what this means to us. And George actually mentioned something that I realized I did not mention during our initial call. So I'm from Alabama, and I actually have a farm in Alabama. My dad, since 93, has really taken on the project and really the work of managing over 60 acres in Alabama. And it's interesting because he's also from New York and did not grow up, on the land or really connected to what it means to grow or to raise livestock and really be, giving and working in that space. But his experience as a young kid going upstate New York offered him that opportunity. And so I really see that living off the land as kind of through him, my way of connecting to it. I've been learning a lot about farming and really what it means to reimagine and shift our perspective on how land can really offer us peace, stress-free or stress-reducing outlets, as well as food and other nourishment for our mind, for our spirits, and for our bodies. And the other side of that, I think about my role at the National Park Service and from the lens of public health, and we're really looking at who exists in spaces such as public lands and national parks? What are their identities? What are their backgrounds? and what they can really learn in those spaces. And so I'm interested definitely in our discussion today. I know that it's gonna be great, but to continue to explore how we can really connect with all communities and specifically the Black community within national parks and really just inspire a reconnection, not necessarily a connection, but a reconnection to what I feel like has been a natural part of who we are and in our community. So thank you.
Great, thank you all for sharing with us. So, you know, Subria, you shared with us your connection to the land and learning more and more about farming. I'd like to ask each of the panelists, if you haven't said so before, what do you see as the meaning for you for living on and off the land? Some of you have spoken to it, but if anyone wants to add anything before we show the film, I would love to hear it.
I would love to add something. One of the things that I did not mention as well is that my grandfather also has land in the South. And actually next month, I was just having a conversation with my mother because she has inherited acres of land and we're trying to figure out what to do, you know, with these acres of land that we inherit. And one of the issues that we often talk about is, you know, like selling grandma's house or selling the land that, you know, selling the things that have come before us. So I'm really interested in this shift in perspective of how we're like coming back home and reconnecting in a way that is, that I like, it's almost magical and divine in terms of this very clear reconnection that all of us feel that, you know, we're really trying to figure out how to harness that energy.
And I'd like to also add that land, there's a spiritual connection to land. There's something physical and emotional and mental about having land that is yours, that has actually been passed down from generation to generation. When I go on that property in South Carolina, I can feel my grandparents, my great-grandparents, and great-great-grandparents. And understanding what that struggle was 120, 130 years ago for Black people, maybe 30 or 40 years post-Civil War to be able to buy and own land and work that land. And so it's really important for us to be able to pass that down for future generations, but then also to think of it in a modern context. So how we utilize that land is really important and making sure that it works for future generations.
And I'd like to speak to the community of people who may have had family land at one time, but that land has been lost. I think, for example, there's only 1% African-American people who own land presently. And so the off the land piece, I think, is so very important to remember and recall. And I know that we have urban farm initiatives that are growing, and that is so wonderful. People are absolutely connecting more to the land. I would like to see more initiatives that bring those urban populations or those people who have been disconnected to the land. I'd like to see them come back to the family structure, to the people or to the places where, you know, families do have land. So in other words, more collaborative experiences, perhaps, particularly for youth, you know, who, like I said, you know, their families, for whatever reason, don't have land. Thank you.
One thing I'd like to add just quickly, Monica, you touched on a really good point. A lot of the conversations I've been having with my dad about our farm and just what that looks like, as you mentioned, George, in the modern sense, has been around how this can be profitable in some sense, but how it can really be sustainable and be a part of this legacy that he's leaving behind, that I will also leave behind. And so one of the things that we're actually doing, he is a veterinarian. He graduated from Tuskegee University from the vet school. And so he has maintained a really close partnership with the vet students there and the students. And a lot of them are coming from, you know, all over the country. Many of them are interested in agriculture, but have never really had that experience. And so they've been able to come out to our farm and actually learn how to take care of animals, how to deworm goats, how to raise chickens, how to pull fence, and really have an opportunity to reconnect with that space. I think it really is powerful because you're able to, in terms of crops, see where your food is actually coming from, but feel that connection that may have been lost in the years past. So that's something we're really trying to continue to pour into and navigate. Again, we are not, very familiar with development or having to create internship opportunities, but that's something that we're definitely exploring at our farm in Alabama.
That's beautiful. And I think that this discussion could be, we should be inspired and excited that Black farmers are maybe getting some significant relief through the Emergency Relief for Farmers of Color Act, which is a part of the $1.9 trillion COVID-19 panic relief bill. So we wanna give our thanks to Senator Warnock, Senator Cory Booker, Senator Elizabeth Warren, and all of those who have contributed to this. And the since we're talking about farms and getting back to the farm, I have, since with my work in farming and agriculture, I have a great, anticipation for what's gonna happen with this legislation. So that's great. So with that, I want to go into showing the film of 20 and Odd. You guys, this is an inspiring film. If you haven't seen it, it's awesome. You're really in for a treat. I'm looking forward to discussing it later and some of the other things that we want to discuss. This film explores the trauma, resilience, and beauty of the African-American experience in our country, and it conveys a story of African-Americans in parks in an authentic way. So anyone from the National Park Service, would you like to add a note of introduction for the film?
I can talk a little bit about the film. So the idea of the film was actually, it happened in 2011 when I was an intern at the National Park Service. I was asked to, there was a slave village that was discovered in Frederick, Maryland at one of our national parks, which is called Monocacy National Battlefield. And I was sent there to cover and film the excavation. But while I was there, I was listening to my favorite artist at the time. It was Tupac and the song called Still I Rise. When I was listening to the song, I remember watching these HBCU interns excavating through the dirt and just finding remnants. And I just had this profound sadness come upon me because to me, it looked like these kids were like digging through the dirt, finding what could have been their ancestors. So I went back to the office and I looked up the lyrics to Still I Rise, and I discovered Dr. Maya Angelou's poem, Still I Rise, which I had never heard before. And I put that to some audio, and I sat on that audio for 8 years trying to get funding for this film. And thankfully, to people like George McDonald and other people in the Park Service, we were able to procure that funding. And I worked with six of my colleagues, six Black women, including Subria Spencer. And they took Dr. Maya Angelou's speech and matched it with shots and scenes based on their life and their culture. So it was such an important film. And in 2011, I set out, I wanted to make a film about the beauty of African-American culture. And if you look at the comments for that film, I think 90% of the comments are always saying beautiful. So I think we hit exactly what we meant to do. So I don't know if Sabrina or George has anything to say.
Thank you, Mathew. Okay, and so now we'll show the film, 20 and Odd. And afterwards, you know, someone can talk about the significance of the title, 20 and Odd. Okay, here we go.
Thank you. Everyone in the world has gone to bed one night or another with fear, pain, or loss, or disappointment. And yet each of us has awakened and risen, somehow made our ablution, seen other human beings, and said, morning, how are you? Fine, thanks, and you? It's amazing, wherever that abides in the human being, there is the nobleness of the human spirit. Despite it all, we rise. You may write me down in history with your bitter, twisted lies. You may trod me in the very dirt, but still like dust, I'll rise. Does my sassiness upset you? Why are you beset with gloom? Just cause I walk as if I have oil wells pumping in my living room. Just like suns and like moons, with the certainty of tides. Just like hope springing high, still I rise. Did you want to see me broken? Bowed head and lowered eyes, shoulders falling down like teardrops, weakened by my soulful cries. Does my sassiness upset you? Don't take it so hard just because I laugh. As if I have gold mines digging in my own backyard. You can shoot me with your words. You can cut me with your lies. You can kill me with your hatefulness. But just like life, I'll rise. Does my sexiness offend you? Oh. Does it come as a surprise that I dance as if I have diamonds at the meeting of my thighs? The huts of history's shame, I rise. Up from a past rooted in pain, I rise. A black ocean leaping and wide, welling and swelling, I bear in the tide. Leaving behind nights of terror and fear, I rise. Into a daybreak miraculously clear, I rise. Bringing the gifts that my ancestors gave, I am the hope and the dream of the slave. And so, naturally, there I go rising.
All right. Thank you so much. That was awesome. That's awesome. Can anyone speak to the title, 20 and Odd?
Hello. I'm kind of trying to hold back tears over here because I still get emotional every time I watch it. The title came from us just doing a bit of research about the 400 commission efforts, about Fort Monroe, about 1619, looking through historic documents, talking with our chief historian, Dr. Takaya Lowe, about different sites. And of course, we came across the famous diary entry by John Rolfe, documenting how many individuals, not even the exact number, but a rough estimate of how many individuals were on the White Lion, the ship that arrived at Point Comfort, which is Fort Monroe, a national park site. And for us, we really saw that as an opportunity after fighting through tears and frustration and all of the things, as we thought about the past, really saw it as an opportunity to reclaim that phrase in a way, and pay homage and give honor to our ancestors and those individuals who were counted or mentioned in those historic documents. And so for us, when we can go into more of this, but for us, it was really a struggle to figure out what the title should be, because we wanted to talk about so much and we wanted it to be really impactful, but that's ultimately what we landed on.
And I'd like to add to Subria's comments is that this film also was about young people taking control over the narrative, because the narrative was not being spoken in the right format and the right things were not being said. And this was such an powerful statement by making this film, and my hat is off to the entire team.
I'd like to share my reflection after watching the film, and it aligns with what was just spoken on about narrative. Because I live in Richmond, Virginia, which is formerly the capital of the Confederacy, it really, we were sort of in the throes of the whole 400 years commemoration and reflection of the experience, particularly the land where it is noted more than 50% of America's population has roots to. And so as we went through that narrative of the enslavement and walking the Richmond Slave Trail, for example, we came to the sense of the need to switch the narrative up, to remember our indigenous, our aboriginals, our authentic selves in that space, that we are, as it was spoken earlier, we have the right to air and to land. And so in the vein of renewal and in the vein of restoration and reclamation, we walk that space, in the ideology of Black love and sacredness. We walk that space and came to reclaim it in a way by creating a monument there, actually. So it speaks powerfully. And so thank you.
And if I may, I think that's a perfect kind of segue into urban agriculture, right? And really trying to figure out the layers and all that comes with urban agriculture and this new kind of name that seems to be tossed around. And here in the district, we have a department of urban agriculture and a director of urban agriculture. And I'm really excited for the Well to partner directly with the Urban of Agriculture, the Department and Director of Urban Agriculture, to really just move and redefine what all of this means for our community in a way that works for us. So when you look at urban ag, at times there's like the park and community garden space, right? Like the public space. And then there's also the food production and the sustainability that comes with that. And one of the things that I would suggest that we do is really define for ourselves, what does urban agriculture mean? Are we talking about nature growing things, which is like park space and, gardening, community gardening? Or are we talking about sustainable food options, which then may include aquaponics and hydroponics and controlled environment growing, which is kind of a different lane than, having fun outdoors and doing stuff for recreational purposes. So I think it's important to kind of define, what that means for you individually, or you as a for-profit or nonprofit or a city, to figure out kind of what your lane is and decide to move forward in that. And I'm really excited for us to begin to explore in many different levels and layers what that means and how we as a people can begin to reconnect with the land. I'll just say that my personal experience before this, all of my jobs were in government, right? Which means that I wore button-up suits and blazers and heels, the whole representative look, right? But now I work in a garden and I get to wear overalls and have my hands in the dirt on a regular basis. And if I show up to your meeting dirty, that doesn't mean that I'm any less worthy. That means that I was actually doing my job, right? And to be able to redefine for myself what it means to be professional in my own capacity, it's this whole like pride moment that's like taking off the lens of sharecropper, because that's what everybody said our folks did in the South, and recognizing that I come from a people who owned land, who worked land, who produced their own food. So it's not always this consumption mindset, that we have been a very productive people, and I myself am a very productive person. So we begin to reassign value in a different way. At the well, your money don't make money, doesn't make anything grow any faster in this space. So recognizing what it means to really grow, like not just grow things in the dirt, but to also grow ourselves, being patient with that, being kind and doing the things that it takes to just reconnect. Yeah, like that's the energy of what we're reclaiming that our ancestors knew and that we're very clearly passing on to the to our children. Like my babies, if y'all can hear them in the background, like they are literally the reason why I do all of this. Like they are the reason why I put my hands in the ground, because they need to know that not only am I growing them, but I'm growing a better environment and I'm making the world better for them.
That's wonderful. That's beautiful. So let me just make sure that we are addressing this question that has come up from the audience, a question from Pete on the topic of food insecurities in America. And it's a two-part question. First, how can this conference and organizations engage on the planning, development, and implementation of urban agriculture? And also over... over the past decade, there has been high interest in urban agriculture with many not-for-profits, businesses, and municipalities. So how have individuals launching urban agriculture ventures struggled or failed? So if we haven't, let's delve into a little bit more. If we haven't answered the question, is there some trepidation going into urban agriculture? Or is it something that we're jumping into, in full force and reminding ourselves of our past connection with the land?
Well, I work in urban agriculture, and the most difficult thing is the access to land. I grow hemp, for example, and there's only so much you can do with very small spaces. It's great for individual consumptions to feed the family, but the networks absolutely need to be expanded to put the community pieces together. So we have urban spaces around, and I'm just speaking to the area where I live now. We have, the well, for example. I don't know how many acres you have, but there are places that have several acres where, communities can come to, but there's still not enough to feed, a whole community. Like the whole community needs to be involved in urban agricultural kind of ventures. So I think we still have a ways to go, even though it's a wonderful start to include and enfold more expansive networks to green spaces and gardening.
Absolutely. And I think we have to look back in the spirit of Sankofa. We have to look back to where we've been. There were schools called Rosenwald schools that were in our communities in the South and other places in the country. And it was absolutely necessary and required to have a school garden. And this is how young people learned how to grow things. This was a great legacy that somehow got dropped. And so we have to go back to those kinds of things. So any other questions? I mean, any other comments basically on those questions about urban agriculture and how we can get back to the land?
You know, I would also say, let's try to intentionally engage our HBCUs. If we look at Florida A&M or, you know, any of the agricultural schools, so many of our of us and our educational institutions have that rooting and that history. And if we can reconnect in a very intentional way that amplifies the research and all of the opportunities and without the shame that once came with it. One of the things that, you know, Ms. Monica identified is that it's hard work, right? Like working the land is hard work. And that's a reason why a lot of our people have turned away from that. But if using the resources and the smarts and the technology that we have, turning that on its head, I mean, who knows what the possibilities are?
I also think that we should tie urban agriculture with some of the bigger primary initiatives of the Biden administration around climate change, health disparities. I mean, urban agriculture, I mean, if you're eating better, your health is going to be better. Being able to access food closer to where the people are will cut down on carbon emissions. And I think these are things that we also need from a strategic standpoint to make those connections and hold our political leaders accountable for making sure that we get the resources to make these things possible.
Absolutely. And in this region, I think there's a lot of emphasis on urban agriculture. Ever since we had a 2010 Urban Ag Summit at the University of Maryland in connection with the Beltsville Agriculture Research Center. And ever since then, it's been, you know, there's been an explosion of interest in it. So we at Prince George's County, we have an urban ag specialist and an urban ag planner. And I think that there's just a lot of potential for many people to get back to the land through urban agriculture. So that's great. Now, we have another question here from Maya. I know most of us here can relate to valuing the earth and the future it bears. What advice can the panelists give for ways to share the value of the land with fellow people of color who may be unaware of the connection to the land? So how can we share the value of the land with you know, our friends, our neighbors, our family members who don't particularly feel a great connection to the land? And I have to say, one way would be to, I think, to go and visit some of the National Park Service sites. It's awesome, they're awesome. Fort Monroe, someone mentioned Fort Monroe, and I encourage you all to check that out. I'm gonna go the next time I go to Virginia, but look it up, there's a lot of history there. So who wants to take on that question?
Yes, I'll start. Great question. In the Office of Public Health, we really are often thinking about ways in which we can connect individuals that feel disconnected or feel no sort of connection to land, to parks, to sites and monuments. I would say that part of a major goal of 20 and odd was to really connect a new audience. You see that there were different generations featured throughout the film. All of the individuals were actually volunteers, and many of them had not been to a National Park Service site. Or if they had, they didn't realize that it was a National Park Service site. You know, there were in the Atlanta scene at MLK's birth home, many individuals in that scene that lived in the same neighborhood and did not know that it was there and did not know that it was part of the Park Service. And so a large part of our efforts were really focusing on coming at the role of parks in the connection of our history and trying to stress that you have roots here, you have space here, you know, your being, your ancestors, all that you are is also connected to this place or the places across the country. And so that's definitely a push. And then from the health aspect, George touched on it. I think there's a real need for us as Black folks to view parks and view public lands and land in general as a health resource for us. You know, there are many things happening that have been happening in our country. And it's hard when you're just trying to navigate life and you're existing within systems that are literally designed to harm you, literally designed for you to fail. And so being able to view land as this health resource, as a place to relieve stress, as a place to come and do everyday activities that you would normally like to do in parks is really key and really something that we're trying to push, both for mental health, physical health, and overall wellness.
Okay, beautiful. Anyone else?
You know, I'll say that here in DC, we have a really interesting relationship with the National Park Service spaces, as well as like our own parks and green space. And oftentimes like National Park Service people are looked at like the rangers, are looked at like as the police, and everybody within National Park Service with, you know, sometimes looks like not the community that we come from, right? Like there's National Park Service looks like a very white organization. And we don't often show up. And there's this question about, am I supposed to be here? Is this really for me? And I really appreciate particularly the people on this panel and the barriers that you all are working through to make sure that that we are sometimes in places that we are underrepresented, that we show up and see ourselves. Again, particularly here in DC, we have a lot of parkland. And because the park police, like, patrol the parkland, it's this very sometimes contentious relationship with the federal parkland. But I appreciate, again, the work that you guys have done, as well as some of the work of the people like within your network, like the Big Brown Get Down, who has really tried to make sure that those networks and spaces where Black and Brown people don't show up, that our young people see the reflection of themselves in a lot of different spaces. So making sure that, like, we're able to intertwine and show up, whether we're the first, the second, or the third, but making sure that we're opening the door for everybody behind us and lifting as we climb. You know, that's the spirit of how we can better intertwine and work and relate and, you know, get grounded with our land again.
All right, excellent. Okay, we have a question from Justin. Do you think there should be more individual grant opportunities to get people into gardening in an urban environment? So we're going to back to urban gardening, urban ag as something that is good for your health, something that's good for the environment. So he's asking, should we have more individual grant opportunities? And I would suggest checking with your local sources, your local governments, your state government, and also from USDA, and look for funding. Also, funding could be coming from this relief bill. So keep a close eye on that too. Anyone care to address that question?
You know, I would expand beyond gardening. Let's also include, you know, sunbathing, birding, skiing, hiking, all of the things that can get us outside and, you know, more sunlight and interacting with our parks and green space in a better way. So absolutely. But I wouldn't limit it to just gardening and urban agriculture. Also looking at environmental wellness and, you know, all of the sustainable things that just make us better as a people.
And I'd like to also contribute that in urban gardening, from what I've seen so far, a lot of the grants are, I can't speak to a lot of the grants, but I can speak to some of the grants that come down from the agricultural side versus grants for green spaces in the city. And often those are selectively applied to nonprofit organizations. And so I would also, I would say, yes, there is absolutely a need to fund individual efforts. Again, urban gardening is often a smaller enterprise. You know, somebody who's at their house, you know, trying to go beyond, you know, a container, for example. And, you know, there may be grants for a container, but he may want to take it beyond that, you know, an individual. So I would just say yes to that question. As it's been already said, there are absolutely a number of agricultural funding opportunities that's, that are awesome, but for individuals outside of farming, in other words, in urban agriculture, I think there's absolutely a need.
Awesome. Okay, well, here we have a question from Melody for George or others too. And we've touched on this a little bit already in the discussion, but Melody says, I was the first Black female forester in the USDA Forest Service. Why do you think more Black people don't use national parks and national forests? So we've touched on it a little bit and maybe we can go into it a little bit more.
Yeah, well, I'm following in your footsteps, Melody, and they're big shoes to fill. But I think that there are a number of factors. I think access to national parks and national forests have always been an issue. And a lot of the work that I do with youth programs, we have developed these partnerships with nonprofits, and some of them are really big nonprofits, some are smaller, to improve access, getting kids in particular out to these sites. Like some of the work that we do at the YMCA, annually we're bringing close to 20,000 kids into national parks for activities around recreation, education, service, all of these things, to get them into these places where they might not be able to get to because of the barriers of transportation and economic disparities. But I also think that we need to look at the land as not just the federal public land space, but also the local and state land spaces, and think about the mission of getting people engaged in green space, having people become activists around what is going to happen to this limited, finite amount of open green space, and should a small minority of people who happen to control a lot of money control all the access to the green space. And I think that is a much, much bigger discussion. And we also need to link it around some of the themes that we've already been talking about. So when we talk about this space, what are we going to do with this space? Do Black people look at the space culturally the same way as other groups? And this goes for a lot of different groups. We've got to look at a lot of different models with how to utilize the public lands, and then who has the access to the public lands, and then what are the policies for the management and sustainability of those lands? So it's a complex issue, but it's actually a simple solution, and that is improving opportunity and getting rid of racism and economic equality, and looking at race equity as being one of those guiding principles.
Thank you, George. Thank you. Okay, so we also have a question from Joyce in the audience. Are there any issues with soil quality in the urban gardens? So maybe some of you can speak to that, Jaren, and others, but also in relation to urban gardens, urban parks and open spaces, are there issues with safety? Do people always feel safe in urban open spaces? And is that a reason why we don't delve into these spaces more?
Yeah, I can speak to soil quality and safety living in an area which is that ranks very high in terms of health risk in the nation. And as a matter of fact, I think the reason why container gardening is a popular avenue is because of the concern around soil quality. In terms of safety, and in my experience in taking walks and, you know, trails, safety is absolutely an essential factor in people feeling comfortable in park spaces. And Jaren has already spoke to park rangers, you know, at the state and local level. Access is very important. You know, how comfortable do you feel in a park space? And not only, you know, is somebody, does somebody have the key to allow you to feel welcome in a park space, or do you feel like you have ownership of the park space? You know, how close are you with it? And what are the barriers to your enjoyment? So all of those factors should be considered. I know that I have spoken with many elderly people who were just not comfortable with going to park spaces because they've had very traumatic experiences within parks, you know, with the history of it. And we also, in our conversations, have to remember that park spaces, although, you know, as a result of the Civil Rights Act, we have open access to spaces now, this was not always the case. And, you know, there used to be separate parks for separate people. So I'm glad that we're at this space that we are now and moving forward.
Great. Anyone else want to add to that?
I'll say that soil quality in urban environments is always an issue. Like, that's an environmental issue, particularly when you look at where they allow, you know, our neighborhoods to kind of, the spaces that our neighborhoods are often built on top of. But I'll say that with our particular urban site, we actually have really good soil quality. So we're really fortunate with our little pocket, you know, when you begin to do the soil testing and things. So our particular quality of soil at the well is really awesome, you know, compared to traditionally where urban gardening and land sites and spaces that Black and Brown people are allowed to occupy. But then when we talk about the safety of these spaces, things like lighting and tree sight and eyesights have always been an issue, right? Like, those, our spaces have been neglected for a while, which allows the deterioration and the, you know, lights don't work here and a gap in the concrete there. So this, like, traditional neglect has definitely increased the safety concerns in our parks. You know, but I'll say that, like, our attitude is kind of by any means necessary, and we're going to make our spaces better. So what are the steps that we have to take in order to demand better lighting, in order to, you know, if we have to go in there with a machete ourselves and cut back the wooded areas to make sure that it looks better. If we have to organize our own cleanup days. You know, what I'm seeing, not just from my peers, but even our babies are literally creating cleanup days within themselves because they're tired of walking over trash. So when we look at our own, like, resilience, what we've decided to do with the strength of ourselves and our ancestors, with the resources that we're now demanding from the administration and with the resources that we can acquire when we value ourselves, man, like, who knows what's gonna happen? Like, I'm just really excited to be, like, what a time to be alive. Like, it's an amazing time to really say, this is what we are doing. And these are the steps that we're taking to make that happen.
Great, thank you so much, everyone, for this, for your contributions on the gifts that you brought to the audience on this panel. Thank you so much. Have a great afternoon.